Hodder & Stoughton Limited presents Letters from Brenda, Two Suitcases, 75 Letters, One Mother by Emma Kennedy. Read by Emma Kennedy and Juliet Stevenson. I want to tell you the story of my mother. When she died, I was a mess, caught in a riptide of grief I had no chance of escaping. But by small degrees, I found myself floating out of it. I wasn't quite sure what to do next. Grief does funny things to you. It makes you wary and desperate, as if you found yourself in an unwanted friendship with someone who is overly needy. It demands things of you, forcing you to lay bare a life, cradle to grave. It requires you to stare at a person under an unflinching light. Grief is a terrible burden. It has taken me 7 years to be able to write this book. It's a story of a girl, a teenager, a woman, a wife, a lover, a mother. It's a story that involves betrayal, bigamy, disappointment, a suicide attempt, affairs, love, passion and fury. My mother and I had a complicated relationship. She was difficult and volatile. But I knew that wasn't the whole story. In fact, I realised, I didn't really know her story at all. I had no idea what I would find when I lifted the rocks of her life. I hadn't intended to do it. But a sudden, unexpected call from my father changed all that. This is the story of Brenda. Chapter 1. My mother died on a warm spring day. 2 weeks previously, she'd been sitting on a low chair looking up at my cousins, Ben and Tom, waxing lyrical about a pair of tight white trousers she used to wear as a young teacher. They were marvellous, she told us, but they were hideously embarrassing when I had a sexual ooze. You could see everything. My cousins had screamed. My dad had put his head in his hands and I had rolled my eyes. My mother, as she always did, rocked backwards, cackling, absolutely delighted she'd been outrageous. Sexual ooze, she said again, with a determined wickedness. Oh, for a sexual ooze! I didn't know it, but it was to be the last time I saw my mother laugh. I was called home, summoned by a telephone message picked up during a lunch break. I was in a writer's room for a children's animation series, and as everyone tucked into their sandwiches, laughing and exchanging light gossip, I took myself outside and stood on the pavement in London's Portland Place, staring up at a clear blue sky. "You have to come home," my dad said, "as soon as you can." I felt a dull dread. Brenda's cancer had returned 18 months previously, another lump in her breast. We had sat in a small consultant's room at the Royal Marsden, lined up on plastic chairs, backs to the wall, as if we were about to be given detentions. A man with salt and pepper hair and his sleeves rolled up came in and told us the cancer was back. This time, there was no fixing it. I reached for my mother's hand, and neither of us said anything. The following months were no fun for my mother. She lost her hair, developed debilitating lymphedema, a build-up of fluid in the soft body tissue of her left arm, and lost all interest in living. It was a terrible, sad withering of the most vital person I have ever known. Brenda was not the dying kind. I wasn't quite sure what to do. I was contracted to work for the rest of the day, and I was with people I didn't know well. I was shell-shocked, anxious and heavy, unable to tell anyone what had just happened. So I sat in that writer's room and tried to contribute, but my heart was sinking. I had to go home, and I had to do it now. But you don't stand up in a room of relative strangers and say, "Sorry, my mother's dying, I have to go." so I lied and said I was leaving for a voiceover I'd forgotten about. Everyone, I'm sure, thought I was awful. When I arrived home, I was greeted by my father, who burst into tears. He ushered me into the sitting room where we stood in front of a large mirror as he told me to expect the worst. She was upstairs, he told me, had deteriorated. This was it. We held each other. I caught a glimpse of our reflection, broken, holding each other up. It was one thing to feel it. I didn't need to see it. Before I went upstairs to see her, Brenda had asked my father to show me something. It was a DVD from one of my uncles. He'd found some footage of my parents' wedding day and had sent it off to a place that converts old film reels. Now it was in my father's hand, a silver disc with the past on it. He put it on. It was 1966. England was about to win the World Cup, and my mother was in a mini dress run up the day before by my dad's sister. She looked like Julie Christie. My dad looked like he couldn't believe his luck, his sleeves shoved up beyond his elbows ready for business, and a grin so wide it could have torn his face in two. They were in the back garden of a miner's terraced cottage in Wales. A string of washing flapped behind them. They were laughing and dancing and smiling at the camera, their whole lives ahead of them. And here we were, watching it with leaden hearts. I cried, then pulled myself together. I had to go upstairs. There is a weight like no other treading towards the dying. There's a turn in the stairs of my family home, and I stopped there for a moment, holding on to the banister for dear life. It was like being at the top of a steep drop, that moment when you know you have to commit to the jump. She was in my childhood bedroom, in the double bed they'd only got for me after I had my own flat and lived half an hour away. It had been a running joke. I had no need to ever stay over again. My mother had presented it to me with a loud ta-da, before adding, "It's got drawers underneath the mattress," as if that were an unimaginable magic. She pulled them all out to prove it. Every single one was stuffed with old pillows. "So many pillows," I had offered. "You can never have enough pillows," she replied. For the best part of 40 years, every time I returned home, I had slept in an ancient single bed slammed into the corner of the room. It had an old metal frame that rattled every time I moved. The mattress was like a coffin, the springs furious. Every time I shifted, pulled at the covers or breathed, it was like listening to someone clattering about on a pogo stick. I'd hear my mother laughing from the room next door. She never stopped finding it funny. But that bed was now gone, and instead there was this new bed with all the pillows hidden inside it. I pushed open the door. She was lying on her side, cheek pressed into the sheet. She couldn't sit up. "Hello, you," I kept my tone light, as if this was just another little setback. She reached her hand out, and I kneeled down to take it. And in that moment, I collapsed. I hadn't expected sadness to take my legs away, but it did. This was suddenly very real. My mother, the inimitable Brenda, the woman to whom I owed everything, the woman who had made my life exciting, complicated and hard, the woman who had made me laugh the most, cry the most, the woman who had been the cloud, the light, the joy, the terror, the burden, was leaving. I didn't know what to do. As I wept, she looked at me. Her voice was shallow and thin. "At least I know you love me." It might strike you as an odd thing for her to say, but we'll get on to that. A month before, a doctor had rung my father to tell him that yes, the x-rays they had taken of my mother's chest had revealed the cancer had spread to her lungs. We decided not to tell her. Instead, we told her she had a chest infection, something that might clear up. She knew that wasn't true, of course, but for a while, it helped us all to pretend it was. There's a settling in when someone is dying, where the purpose of any given day is simply to get through it. My mother was in a terrible state in those final weeks, her left arm so swollen, her wrist looked dislocated, her skin red and leathery. She had bloody lesions across her chest and neck. She stank of death. I could smell her rotting. Still, I was in a state of denial. I knew my mother wasn't going to get better, but I refused to absorb or accept it, and so those last days were spent in a state of suspended shock. In the mornings, volunteers from the local hospice would come and change her dressings and wash her. Every time they came, I would stand at the bottom of the stairs and cry. Kindness is such a small, simple thing, but it's so rarely given. I am always astonished by it. In the afternoon, we would be visited by the district nurse, and Dad and I would heave a sigh of relief. My mother loved all the nurses who looked after her. She was nothing but sunshine and light for strangers, putting on the dazzle for people she would never see again. She was a master of the brief encounter. Longer friendships were harder for her. She slipped into a cycle of trying to sleep and sitting up when she felt unwell. Occasionally, I would try and feed her a few mouthfuls of salmon and avocado, her favourite, but she was having difficulty swallowing. When she slept, I lay in the bed next to her and worked. I had an animation script to finish, was working on a novel, and was also finalising the pilot script for The Kennedys, the show in which my mother was the lead character. I had a call from Catherine Parkinson, who had been cast to play Brenda. She asked if she could meet her, but we'd left it too late. I had to say no. It's still one of my greatest regrets. The slow grind towards death was relentless. And yet, through the thick of sadness, there were moments where the old Brenda peeped through. She had asked me to read her the script of The Kennedys, and as I was relaying a dinner scene, she placed a hand on my arm to stop me. I'd just read out a speech of my father's, one where he named someone I'd known as a child. "You'll have to take that out," she whispered. "He still sees her in Sainsbury's." The days dragged on. My cousin, Adrian, arrived with his wife and children. They stood at the end of the bed and said their goodbyes. "Have a nice life," my mother said to them as they left, and I had to slip into another room and cry. I asked her if there was anyone else she wanted to see, whether she wanted to be given the last rites or be buried in a Catholic church. She said no to everything except her sister Phyllis and her nephews Ben and Tom. She tried to tell me the name of a Gerard Manley Hopkins poem she'd like read at her graveside, but couldn't recall the name of it. I ran a few by her to see if it might help, but she was so weak I had to give up. Sunday came. It was beautiful and warm. Phyllis arrived with my cousins. It was such a relief to see them. Dad was exhausted. I don't think he'd slept properly in weeks. We took it in turns to sit with her, sometimes holding her up, other times sitting beside her, cradling her hand. She had quiet conversations with her sister, with whom she'd had a tumultuous and difficult relationship. Apologies were offered. Brenda was saying goodbye. The district nurse popped in. I'd had difficult, serious discussions in the days before as to when would be the right time to put my mother onto the syringe feed that meant we wouldn't see her awake again. I had been concerned my mother was suffering, but as long as she could eat a little and speak a little, there was a reluctance to do this. "I've been trying to feed her, but she's having trouble swallowing." We were talking over my mother, who was propped up on one pillow. One pillow, when she was lying on a bed rammed with the things. Why we didn't think to get out four or five and make her more comfortable, I will never know. She looked like an abandoned sack. I tried giving her some chopped up apple earlier, I added. The district nurse looked at me as if I was quite mad. Why are you trying to give her apple? Give her something that's easy to swallow, like yogurt or ice cream. Ooh, ice cream. My mother's eyes suddenly lit up. Do you want some ice cream? She nodded. I didn't need asking twice. I ran down the stairs with a jump in my step. She was rallying, I thought. Perhaps this was a little setback after all. I put two scoops of vanilla ice cream into a bowl and took them up to her. Do you want me to feed you? She shook her head and took the spoon. I walked the district nurse out, thanking her as I did every day. She told me to call her if there were any problems. I told her I would. Phyllis and the boys had brought some picnic-style food with them and had started to lay out plates in a small, sun-filled room off the sitting room that looked out over the garden. It was Mum's favourite place to sit. I pulled out some serving spoons for them and went back upstairs. Mum had finished the bowl of ice cream. I stared down into it, eyes wide. Have you eaten all that? She looked up at me and nodded. It was lovely. Her voice was barely more than a whisper, but it was music to my ears. Ecstatic, I ran downstairs to tell Dad she might be on the mend. Dad looked at me and said nothing. My cousin Ben took over sitting upstairs with her, and I returned to the lunch things, helping to lay them out. The mood was light. There was laughter. Phyllis was her usual entertaining self, reeling out stories about old family members and complaining about her wrinkles. I had just scooped some food onto my plate when Ben appeared in the doorway, his face ashen. Brenda's vomited. It's a lot. Everyone jumped up. Dad, Phyllis, Tom and my fiancé Georgie, who had arrived that morning with bags of clothes for the long haul. I stood, plate in hand, frozen, watching them all run out of the room. The moment I had dreaded had arrived. I could do many things for my mother, but looking after her when she was vomiting was not one of them. When I was 7, my father had arrived unexpected at my school. I remember sitting at my desk watching him drive in, wondering why he was there. Moments later, I was taken out of class and delivered to him. My mother had been admitted to hospital. She had renal colic. And Dad had come to get me. I'd never been in a hospital before, and as I walked through the corridors that smelled of disinfectant, a previously unknown fear snaked through me. Brenda was sitting up in bed, a thin blue blanket pulled over her knees. I stood and stared at her, and suddenly she threw up over herself. I thought she was going to die. A month later, the BBC showed their first ever fly-on-the-wall documentary series set in a hospital. The first episode featured a young woman having her stomach pumped. Watching it, I was dragged back to the moment that I thought Brenda was dying. I ran from the room and sat on the stairs, hands over my ears, as I listened to the sounds of the woman being sick. I have suffered from emetophobia ever since. It's a morbid fear of vomit. And now, standing still as everyone else ran to her, that fear was back, like ice hardening over my feet. This time, Brenda really was dying. Upstairs, I could hear my father calling for something, anything, for my mother to be sick into. She was sick again and again and again. Tom came down and sat on the stairs I'd sat on all those years ago, his hands covering his cheeks. There are moments of intense shame that visit us through our lives. Nobody can get everything right. But standing there, listening to what was unfolding, and not being able to go to my mother, will haunt me till I die. I rang the district nurse. She can't stop being sick. She told me she would come as soon as possible. The vomiting stopped, and I trod slowly up the stairs. My aunt was on her knees helping Brenda out of her pyjama bottoms. I found a clean pair and held Mum up as we got her changed.
"Here you are,"
my mother said pointedly at me. I knew what she meant. It was the short but targeted criticism I deserved. Sadly, it was to be the last thing she said to me. The district nurse, good to her word, arrived, and I slipped away, terrified Brenda would be sick again. Phyllis and the boys drifted back to finish their lunch. I felt useless. I don't think I fully appreciated what was happening. Upstairs, I thought my mother was getting an anti-sickness injection, but she wasn't. She was being put on the syringe feed that would carry her to her final moment. This was going to be the last time we saw her awake, and I wasn't with her. Before the district nurse did what she needed to do, Dad told me, Brenda looked at him and said, "Thank you for looking after me." When the district nurse asked her if she'd like to sleep, she replied, "Yes, I'd like to sleep." Those would be her final words. When it was done, Dad came to get me. He wanted to reassure me that Brenda was resting. He took me up to see her. She was sleeping and peaceful. It was all right, I thought. She'd have a rest and then she'd wake up. But before the district nurse could leave, she came in to have another look at Mum. Something had changed. My mother's breathing had become heavy and ugly. The nurse shook her by the arm and called her name. There was no response. She turned to me. "You need to prepare. It's going to be today." I clutched at my lips and stared at the ceiling. This was a nightmare, and I had mucked everything up. I had given her the ice cream that made her sick. I had not been able to help her when she was vomiting. I had not been with her when she was put under. I hadn't heard her final words. This was going to be etched into my heart forever. I had been a coward, and now I had to live with it. There wasn't much chat as we gathered round, just the odd weepy sniffle underpinned by the steady, heavy rasps of my mother's breathing. About an hour in, my aunt told us to go and sit in the sunshine for a bit, get some fresh air. So with things not looking imminent, Ben, Tom, Georgie and I went out into the garden. Dad would call down to us if anything changed. The four of us sat and drank Pimm's, as if we suddenly found ourselves at a garden party. We managed to laugh about something, but I can't remember what. It felt like any other Sunday, but it wasn't. We finished our drinks, made comments about the flowers, and went back to be with Brenda. A blue line had started to snake its way up the inside of her wrist. "Look at that," said Dad, watching her carefully. I put my hand on her arm. "We're all here, Mum." At that moment, my beagle, Poppy, who was devoted to my mother, appeared in the doorway. In all the days we had been there, she hadn't come to Brenda once, but now she padded her way towards my mother's hand, touched it with the end of her nose, then moved back to the doorway and sat. 5 minutes later, Brenda stopped breathing. As Brenda took her last breath, Poppy got up and returned downstairs. "Has she gone?" asked my aunt. Dad nodded, and everyone began to weep thick, heavy tears. I reached for my mother's wrist and pressed my fingers into her pale skin, but I could still feel a weak pulse. "Wait," I waved a hand into the air. "Wait, I don't think she's dead." "It's the end my mother would have loved. Was she dead or wasn't she? She was hooked up to oxygen, so I couldn't be sure. It was like one last joke she'd pulled at the final moment. But she was dead. Brenda was gone." A terrible noise filled the room. I was horrified to discover it was coming from me. My father hadn't had a drink in 7 years, not because he was an alcoholic, but because my mother had gallstones. She'd given up alcohol, and so had he. That evening, he sat in a chair at the end of my mother's bed with a beer in his hand. I sat next to her, stroking her forehead, and Poppy returned, jumped up onto the bed, and lay herself against Brenda's body. We didn't want her to be on her own. Georgie let in the doctor who declared Mum officially dead, and he handed my father a little green book. We were given a number of an undertaker. An hour later, a man in a three-piece suit arrived at the house. He was tall, built like the Carry-On actor Bernard Breslau, his hair slicked back. He was softly spoken and respectful, and he'd come to carry Brenda down the stairs and take her away. Georgie ushered me and my father into the sitting room and shut the door. She insisted on it. She took the undertaker upstairs, put some slippers Brenda loved on her feet, and waited as they zipped her into a bag. She followed her down the stairs, mopping up the drops of urine that fell onto the carpet, and saw the undertaker out, thanking them, then came to tell us it was done. There are moments in life when love sets itself into stone. Neither I nor my father will ever forget that act of kindness. Thank you, Georgie. It made a world of difference. That night, we all went to bed, heavy and stunned with grief. It was over. Brenda, the towering force in our lives, was gone. She had been the person who controlled us, who set the mood, the one everyone was scared of. She had loomed over every aspect of our lives, like the crow that terrifies Tweedledum and Tweedledee. She had been at times a monster, yet here we all were, utterly bereft, grieving a woman who had often made our lives an utter misery. So why be sad? Why grieve the loss of that burden? Because my mother, it seemed to me, had been entirely mad. She wasn't awful. She was ill. The next day, the three of us sat in the garden. The sobbing over, there was now a steady, undramatic drip of tears, as if my body was wringing out the sadness slowly by hand. It was here, toes pressed down into the grass, that I finally had the conversation with my father I'd been waiting to have for 40 years. Do you think Mum had an undiagnosed mental illness? It was a thought that had hung heavy for as long as I could remember. We'd sat in a consultant's room 10 years previously, when Mum was 61, listening to her telling an unsuspecting doctor she'd been given cancer by a CIA operative in a bookshop in Cambridge. She thought her phones were bugged. She refused treatment because she thought it was a plot between Dad and the doctors to have her killed. She thought her neighbours had secretly bought her garden. She thought Freemasons and secret government forces were behind every entirely normal setback any of us faced. My mother was paranoid, occasionally violent, sometimes completely out of control. To anyone with half a scrap of sense, none of this was normal. Yet to us, it was. And so nobody, not once during her lifetime, tried to address it or find her a scrap of help. Yes, he said quietly. I think she probably did. There are so many things to feel guilty about when someone dies. Your relief at their passing, the fact you sat and watched them suffer, the never-ending doubts that perhaps you could have been nicer, kinder, more tolerant. But the one thing I felt most ashamed of was this. My mother, I was positive, had had a serious mental illness, and I did absolutely nothing about it. What had been wrong with her? Was it genetic, caused by trauma? Was it hormonal? Did anyone else in her family have a history of mental illness? I didn't have a clue. It's difficult being around someone who is unpredictable. Brenda could be the greatest person in any room. She had immense presence and charisma. She was so funny, she could leave you breathless and begging for her to stop. She could entertain a crowd. She could hold anyone rapt. She could be generous to a fault. But she could also turn on a sixpence as fast and as furious as a lightning strike. And it was that Brenda, the dark, mean, vicious Brenda, that we all wanted to avoid. So we didn't ask, we didn't discuss, we didn't question. We all had a form of Stockholm syndrome, and nothing ever got better. A day for my mother was not fulfilled without complaining about something. Politicians, the monarchy, although she always watched the Queen's speech and secretly loved her. Neighbours, the state of the drains, anyone who disagreed with her. Her father, my father, not doing what she wanted when she wanted. Driving, she didn't drive. Lorries on motorways, credit card bills, Tory voters, men, all of them. The ripeness of a pear, it didn't matter what it was. My mother loved complaining. But when it came to herself, an actual bona fide suffering, she complained not a jot. And it struck me, suddenly, that she may have spent her entire life suffering, and if she had complained, she might still be alive. The days and weeks and months after my mother's death took their toll. Not a day passed when I didn't think about her. 6 months after she died, she came to me in a dream. She was crawling on the floor wearing the heavy cardigan she wore on the day she passed. She looked weak and tired. "Well," she said, "that was quite the journey." Then she reached for a bowl to be sick in. I've dreamed of her a handful of times since. Each time she's been a little younger, more well. I felt haunted and empty. And the only memories I felt left with were of the difficult Brenda, the sick Brenda, the woman I wasn't sure I'd got on with. Life drifted on. I found myself out of the riptide. But for me, there was no calm. All I was left with were questions that had never been answered. Then 3 years later, we found the letters. My dad, finally, had decided that Dallington, my childhood home, was going to be sold. I was glad, in a way. It was a house where I had many happy memories, but it was also a place of anxiety, tension, and the ultimate sadness. On the day Dad moved out, I was left behind on my own to lock up after the cleaning. I thought I would feel devastated, but I found myself relieved. We were finally leaving the house to Brenda, for whom Dallington had been the totem of her life's achievements. She'd been so obsessed with it. I've absolutely no doubt she'll haunt it. A few weeks later, Dad rang me. The new owner had found two old leather suitcases in the loft. They were filled with letters addressed to me. I'd completely forgotten about them. Did I want them? A week later, the suitcases arrived. They were rammed with letters from Brenda, a treasure trove of light and love and pride. They are letters from a great storyteller, a bold exaggerator, a mischief maker, an absolute devil. And suddenly, I remembered the Brenda I had loved so fiercely, the woman I adored. In that moment, I made a promise that I would endeavour to discover who she really was and provide the answers I craved. I was going to finally try and work out what was wrong with Brenda and why. My mother's mother, Elizabeth, had died 2 months before I was born. But to understand my mother, I had to go back to the beginning. I had to understand where she had come from and what her formative years had done to her. And to do that, it all starts with Elizabeth. My mother's letters are reproduced here unedited, apart from the bits that are so libelous no sensible editor would allow them. None of them are dated, and they are not presented in chronological order. Brenda wrote most of the letters when she was away, travelling with Tony, my dad. She loved an escapade, but most of all, Mum always liked to butt in. I didn't want this book to be any different.
Dear Emmy, have enclosed bottle of Holland and Bee. Hope they're the right thing. We've just had two swelteringly hot days. We couldn't do anything, but temperature is down to the 70s today, thank goodness. We had a good journey home, but I'm starting to become overly neurotic about driving.
My mother could not drive. She tried once when I was 11, attempted to pick me up from school during a driving lesson and reversed into a tree. On the day of her test, she chastised the examiner. When he slapped his hand on the dashboard for her to do an emergency stop, she turned to him and complained, "Don't be ridiculous, I can't stop here, I'm on a hill." She failed. I don't think a day went by when Tony and I didn't thank our lucky stars she never tried again.
We had a nervous hour or so as we came through Northumberland. A motorcycle rally was obviously taking place north of our position, and about 500 motorcyclists drove at us in a disconcertingly speedy way. I don't like being on the roads anymore. We've been looking for reviews. Saw Ben's.
The writer and actor, Ben Moore, my mother loved him. I had been in the Oxford Review with him, and he was forging a career writing and performing wonderfully inventive one-man shows.
The Guardian gave him 4 stars. Must see. That's lovely. We're waiting for yours now. Tony started the new editions for the scrapbook. My gullet is nutritiously awash with organic homegrown vegetables. It's beetroot this week. Tony picked some of the Mirabelle plums and made a sabayon tart. It was tart, but delicious. Pity we can't send one up to you. Hopefully there will still be plenty of veg, apples, etc. when you come back to London. For some crazy reason, I started to cut my toenails when I got back to the hotel in a very dim light.
And now we get to why she wrote the letter in the first place. Nothing gave Brenda more pleasure than a small dramatic tale of disaster. She's preambled us into this gore-filled incident, but be under no illusions. This is a champ at the top of her game.
I cut part of one toe above the nail, and then while I was cutting my big toe and trying to cut that tricky corner bit, I sliced that as well. Staunching the blood of both toes and whimpering with the pain, I then started to pick my nose for a bit of comfort.
One of the very rare occasions my mother made explicit reference to her self-harming. She didn't think of it as self-harm. She thought it was funny.
And promptly had a heavy nosebleed. Tried to reach sink with blood smeared across hand, stumbling with 2 toes wedged with tissue. Tony, naked at the time.
Get used to my father always seeming to be naked at moments of high crisis. I have no idea why this appears to be the norm.
Had to put his pants on, dash outside to the bathroom to get wads of toilet paper for the nosebleed. Couldn't get into bed for 30 minutes as blood was cascading from 3 different wounds. Felt very sorry for myself. Big toe gets infected, swells up menacingly, and can't walk for 2 days. Lesson: have eye test, seal nose, take more mental exercise. I'm reading Foucault's Madness and Civilization.
I'm fascinated, in hindsight, to find my mother reading a seminal study on the meaning of madness through the ages. Foucault was fixated on the evolution of madness within society and culture from the Renaissance, where the mad were revered as truth-tellers, revealing what men are as opposed to what they present themselves as, through to the modern era where madness has become an illness that must be cured or confined. Foucault was criticised at the time for cherry-picking to suit his argument. Natch.
I'm sure it is doing me good. Tony is fixing garage shed roof, and I'm going to walk to town to post this. Write if you have time. Hope everything continues to go well. Keep eating properly and have plenty of rest. Don't offer to be in anyone else's plays, etc. two's enough. We think you are wonderful. All our love, Mum and Dad. We'll write soon. Kiss, 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 kiss. P.S. Thought you and girls might like some naughty bits.
I'm devastated to have to tell you that I have no recollection of what these naughty bits might have been.
Love. Dear M.
Highly unusual. The beginning of this letter is written by Tony, hence the preponderance on timings for journeys, vegetable updates and newspaper clippings. He was the keeper of the scrapbook, of course.
How are you? Hope you're keeping well and not getting too wet in Edinburgh. The weather forecasts always seem to offer the worst in eastern Scotland. We had a good drive home, left Edinburgh at 9 a.m. and arrived in Hitchin at 4:15 p.m, including three short breaks. The garden wasn't too bad, although the tomatoes have suffered a bit from lack of regular watering. We haven't done a great deal since we've been back, enjoying the sunshine, really. We've had a few nice long walks and a trip to Saffron Walden, etc.
Every single time my mother would make Tony drive her to Saffron Walden, it's a 90-minute drive via the A505 there and back again, he'd pull a face and go, "Oh, not bloody Saffron Walden again," as if he was in Gallipoli and had been asked to run 10 miles through trenches. I have no idea what her obsession with Saffron Walden was, but she considered it quite the treat.
I shall be starting my job in a few weeks.
My father was starting a new job in further education, teaching life drawing to Art Foundation students.
And I'm looking forward to that, although it seems I have to have a medical before everything is confirmed. There haven't been any mention of your shows in The Guardian.
The chances of our shows being reviewed in The Guardian were nil. Bless them for looking.
I check every day. Perhaps we missed something while we were in Edinburgh. Do let us know if anything comes out in the Nationals. I expect you will keep cuttings, but it's nice to see things in context, so to speak. There should be some veg for you when you get back. I've got loads of onions in storage, and next week I'll be taking up the potatoes. I think there will be lots. The broccoli is continuing, but in smaller amounts, and the beans are more or less over. There will be plenty of beetroot, cabbage and, later on, sprouts and parsnips if you'd like some. We have lettuce coming out of our ears. I've started preparing some ground for next year, so we must keep everything on the go. If you have any supplies of manure knocking around, do let me know.
I have absolutely no idea why my father thinks I might have a surfeit of manure. I'm in Edinburgh, in a show.
Here's Mum. I've decided to call Tony Cornucopia. Hasn't he done well? He should start a market garden. I haven't done anything so productive, but I'm not apologising. I bought a little book of essays by J.B. Priestley the other day, and one was written in praise of idleness, the essential need to gaze at the sky, dream and contemplate. So, that's me. You never know, I might get a book out of it. We hired some computer games and a PlayStation.
I don't have to tell you how great a surprise this came as, do I? From nowhere, my father became obsessed with shooting zombies. He even drew his own game map so that he knew every room inside out and where the zombies were coming from. I cite my mother's realisation that violent shooter games were not the best use for her downtime as one of her greater decisions.
Resident Evil 2 and Circuit Breakers. Tony is addicted. He wasn't coming to bed until 12:30. I quite like playing for about 15 minutes, but I can't control left and right movements very well, so I end up being killed quite frequently. I also find that playing these games makes me very irritable and aggressive.
No shit, Sherlock.
Not for me. Now make sure you're eating properly and take the tablets.
My mother often made reference to tablets I'm supposed to be taking. There's only one problem with this. I didn't have any and never had.
Right, if you have time. We'll try to phone again. If you're not in, I'll leave a message. Take care. All our love. Mum and Dad. P.S. If you need anything, let us know.
Chapter 2. My grandmother, Elizabeth, was the youngest of seven children, born in 1909 to Henry Kynes and his wife Bridget in a small terrace house in Dublin South Dock. My great-grandfather was a carpenter by trade, good with his hands. He would die at the age of 74 from a combination of heart failure and hemiplegia, a paralysis on one side of the body caused by brain damage or spinal cord injury. Bridget would die 10 years before him from a heart attack. She was just 60. They were Catholics and had experienced tragedy twice. In 1911, at the time of the census, only 6 children were still living. I don't know who their 7th child was, so must presume he or she died in childbirth or shortly after. It's entirely possible Bridget lost more children in childbirth, as Brenda always used to tell me her mother had been one of 13. Death, then, hung heavy over the Kynes. Their son, Arthur, died at the age of 15, the cause registered as pneumonia for 9 days and meningitis for 5. He was away from his family in St. Kevin's, Glen Cree, an inmate of the reformatory school, where he had been for the 3 years before, most likely because he had committed a crime. Elizabeth had one other brother, William, who went to England in 1941, leaving his wife, Alice, and children in Ireland. By 1945, however, he'd got himself into a bit of bother, and on 11th of September, he was front page news in the Evening Herald. For bigamy. Father of 6 children, William Kynes, 40-year-old Dublin joiner, was at the Old Bailey, London today, sent to prison for 4 months for bigamy. Kynes came to England in 1941 to work on bomb damage repairs, said Mr. H.J. Hamblin, prosecuting. In London, he married Miss Mary Thompson, 39-year-old housekeeper, at whose home he had obtained lodgings. Kynes declared that although he told Miss Thompson he was married and had 6 children, she persuaded him to go through a form of marriage at Poplar Register Office in 1941. Miss Thompson, who also pleaded guilty to aiding and abetting Kynes, was also sent to prison for 4 months. Her eldest sister, Jane Eileen, may have suffered a worse fate. She'd married a man called Michael Wine, the son of a Jewish art dealer. This would have been a good marriage, especially for a girl from a poor family, but within months, they'd both disappeared. 2 years later, Michael Wine reappeared, named in a notorious court case in Scotland. He had married a woman called Mrs. Bamberger, a fresh-faced beauty who had fallen for his film star looks. She was the daughter of a navvy and had left her parents aged 16 to join a theatrical chorus. The details of the case aren't entirely clear, but the marriage at Gretna Green to Michael Wine was her third, presumably without being divorced. She was sent to jail not for bigamy, but for perjury. After the trial, Michael bought a ticket to New York and set sail on the SS New Amsterdam, departing from Plymouth on 3rd October 1920. There is no sign of poor Jane, though, and her death was not recorded in Ireland or England. It's entirely possible Michael Wine murdered her, but we will never know. My Aunt Phyllis didn't even know she existed. My grandmother, Elizabeth, never spoke of her. Elizabeth's other sisters, May and Gertie, were, like many Irish men and women before the war, experiencing privation. There wasn't enough work or food, and many were emigrating in the hope they could make a better life for themselves. May was thinking of going to Canada, but Gertie had already left for England. She'd married an able seaman, Leslie Taylor, in 1926. She didn't know it yet, but he was homosexual. Gertie and Leslie had set up home running a guest house in Southend-on-Sea, and it was here that my grandmother Elizabeth arrived, suitcase in hand, to help out and find her feet. She had dark hair and green eyes, a prominent jaw, and an expression of seriousness. She lacked the sociableness of her sister Gertie, preferring to be quiet and go unnoticed. At the same time, a rather shy young man with a shock of strawberry blonde hair was running away from his father in Battersea. Bob was 19, and yet to discover that the man he thought was his father wasn't at all. But here he was, by the sea, a world away from the grime of the Battersea Terrace he lived in. As he walked the streets, he chanced upon my great-aunt's guest house. It was at this moment that my grandparents met. They were two quiet people who had left home to find something different, something better. They fell in love and were married in Portsmouth in June 1939. My grandmother told Robert she was 21. She wasn't. She was 10 years older. It was a difficult time to be an Irish Catholic on mainland Britain. The Irish Republican Army, IRA, had bombed two London underground stations that February, and in August they would plant a bomb in Coventry that killed five and injured 70. Irish migrants were treated with suspicion, not least because the negative stereotypes of the Irish as innately criminal or the carriers of disease still lingered. My grandmother, looking for cleaning work, would have been turned away by signs on doors that read, "No blacks, no dogs, no Irish." It was a prejudice that created a sense of shame and wariness, one that engendered a suspicion of strangers and deterred the making of friends. It would set a course of behaviour that would have profound consequences. There was quite a wait for their first child. 4 years after taking their vows, my mother was born on Friday, 5th of February, 1943, at home, 42 Lower Brook Street in Basingstoke, a small terraced house that looked out over a patch of grass and a few trees. It was an eventful time. General Friedrich Paulus, the leader of the German Sixth Army, the man who had led 250,000 German troops in the siege of Stalingrad, had been defeated, surrendering days before my mother was born, and in defiance of Hitler's orders to fight to the death. It was to be a significant turning point of the war and the beginning of Hitler's fall. Hope was in the air. My grandparents had moved to Basingstoke for work. My grandfather, deaf in one ear, had been refused conscription and was sent instead to work at Thornycroft, a factory building motor vehicles for the war effort. He's described on my mother's birth certificate as a jig borer motor works. In other words, he punched holes in metal. It was here that my grandfather discovered his two great passions, politics and women. Stirred by the Herculean efforts of the Soviets on the Eastern Front, my grandfather became a communist and was duly appointed shop steward on the shop floor. My grandmother was a strict Catholic who voted conservative for the entirety of her life. One can only imagine the conversations that were taking place over the dinner table, but my grandfather had started to see other women, and trouble was brewing. It's not possible to pinpoint precisely when my grandparents' marriage began to irretrievably break down. It was the war, and women were well used to turning a blind eye. But Elizabeth was Catholic, and come what may, that meant one thing. She could not divorce. In any event, there was a natural separation. At the end of the war, my grandfather was sent to Germany to help with the clear-up. He would be away for a year. My mother liked to tell me this was when he became a spy, but we'll get to that later. On his return, the family moved to Ashley Lodge Cottage, a small, boxy council house on the edge of the Freskade Crescent estate in Basingstoke. It was a house that looked and felt different from the rest. There was a sign on the front bearing its name, and it was off a long, rural-looking lane. It's striking, looking at it now, that the lane bears an uncanny resemblance to where Brenda ended up in Dallington. Flanked by trees and stretching off, it was a lane that suggested adventures and secrets. Directly opposite Ashley Lodge was a house that must have looked to my mother's young eyes rather posh. It was detached, with a wooden porch, and had more than two rooms upstairs. It all felt rather exclusive, It's not clear why the semi-detached council house bore the name Ashley Lodge, but it may have been an estate office, somewhere the developer sat waiting to show new tenants into their newly built homes. This was the house where my mother told me she was happiest. She was with her mum and dad, and she had a lane to play in. She put on plays and bossed about the other children. She was outside and free. At the top of the lane were the large green fields of the Basingstoke Sports and Social Club. It must have felt idyllic. Brenda was in her element. Whether this is misty-eyed remembrance is another matter. Her parents were clearly miserable. But despite that, on 24th of June 1949, a little sister, Phyllis, 6 years Brenda's younger, arrived and was brought home to Ashley Lodge. It's difficult to surmise what my mother may have been like as a child before Phyllis came along, but she was about to experience a double trauma. With another child in the house, the decision was made to move to a slightly larger council house at 47 Lefroy Avenue. Brenda was taken from the home she loved. There was no more rural lane, and she now lived in a house she wouldn't be able to pick out in a police lineup. But worse was yet to come. 2 years later, after an endless stream of affairs, Bob had met a woman and run off with her, a rather exciting communist called Kathleen. Elizabeth, in accordance with her religious beliefs, refused to grant him a divorce. It was at this point that the shutting down began. All of Elizabeth's feelings of inferiority crowded in. She was Irish, she was a Catholic, and now she was an abandoned woman. Not only that, but Gertie's husband, Leslie, had taken to indulging in acts of indecency with other men. Embarrassment was overwhelming her on all fronts. "Don't let people know our business," she would tell the girls. Shame, she was teaching them, was to be kept hidden from other people. But there was another, more complicated facet to Elizabeth's character. For all her feelings of inadequacy, she was a bit of a snob. To make ends meet, my grandmother worked as a cleaning lady. In the mornings, she would clean the local bank. In the afternoons, she would clean professional people's houses. She would tiptoe through large rooms filled with lovely things. And when on her own, she could imagine herself the mistress of all she surveyed. If her life had only been a little bit different, all these things might have been hers. Elizabeth, getting used to being around middle-class people, began to develop notions. She had a chip on her shoulder about being Irish and not having a husband, so in order to circumvent her sense of inadequacy, she elevated herself to an odd status. They were far too good to be living on this council estate, she decided, and her daughters, Brenda and Phyllis, were to know their worth. Brenda, in particular, took this all to heart. My aunt's memories of my mother during their Lefroy Avenue years are clear-cut. Brenda was the mad sister, who would think nothing of opening her bedroom window to shout at Phyllis's friends and tell them to be quiet. Given the 6-year age gap with Brenda coming into her mid-teens, I think we can forgive her ignoring her mother's constant pleas to take your sister with you. But one incident stands out. When my mother was 12, just after Bob had left, Brenda tried to kill herself. Phyllis recalls the moment well. She was out in the street on her haunches playing marbles. Behind her from the house, she could hear Brenda shouting at their mother. It was another row, of which there seemed to be more and more. Brenda would have what Phyllis described as temper tantrums, where she lost all control. She would, during one blind fury, run her hand across the top of the mantelpiece, sending every single one of her mother's precious ornaments scattering, breaking them all. She threw her dinner against the wall, and on one occasion, threw a book at a child who had dared to answer her back, eliciting a complaint from a furious parent. Phyllis, entirely used to her big sister screaming, ignored it all, and on that day was concentrating on her marbles. But behind her, the shouting stopped. And moments later, there was a thud.
"Your sister's just jumped from the upstairs window," a playmate commented.
Phyllis turned to see Brenda lying face down on the floor. "I remember my mother telling me she had done this as a child, but it was treated, as difficult things often were, as a bit of a joke. She tried to kill herself by jumping from an upstairs window, she'd laugh." She wasn't complaining. "Were you sent to see a psychiatrist?" I think I asked her once. Questions about mental health were tolerated in the context of her thinking what she'd done was hilarious. "No," she replied. "Nobody did anything. I think I was sent to Auntie Gertie for a bit of cake." Miraculously, she was unhurt. "I was carried by a guardian angel," she would tell me in all seriousness. It was a funny thing to say. She hated the Catholic Church, bitterly so. But once a Catholic, always a Catholic. And she could never pass a Catholic church without going in and lighting candles. I never managed to find out why she had thrown herself from that window. It strikes me now that a child of 12 only does that if they're disturbed or traumatised, but which was it?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.